Our first scripture reading is from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24, verses 36 to 40. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I, myself. Touch me and see. For the ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering, and he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the laws, Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." Please remain seated and let us sing verses 1 and 4 of "Now the Green Blade Rises." Amen.
Has not yet been revealed. Christ is risen, but now what? Turns out the Bible is full of stories of uncertain futures, right? There's Abraham, who's told by God to gather up his wife and all of his stuff and to go to a place that God will later reveal to him. Can you even imagine packing up the U-Haul without even an address to type into the GPS? But it is in this new place that God's promise to make Abraham's descendants into a new people takes root and blossoms. Or what about the story of the exiles who, after generations of captivity in Babylon, are returning home? It's what they've wanted. It's what they've been hoping for so long, but they don't know how things are going to be when they get there. Even when they begin to rebuild the temple, the prophet Haggai tells us, the older folks who could remember how things had been before, they are filled with grief. No future changes could bring back the glory that they had once known, or so they thought. And so the unknown future brought them only sadness. In a few weeks from now, we'll mark the day of Ascension, when the resurrected Jesus leaves the disciples here on earth to finish what he has started without him. And they just stand around dumbfounded, not knowing what to do next. They thought he had the game plan. What would their future be like without him? They didn't know. It's no coincidence that our holy scriptures contain so many stories of people striking out in the face of an uncertain future. Not knowing what might come next is at the heart of our human experience, right? Whether it's medical tests, or career changes, or our children, or grandchildren, whether it's life's big questions about love and meaning, or the next steps we will take as a congregation, we simply can't know how things will turn out. How about that most famous line from the book of Hebrews? Faith is being sure of what you hope for, and certain of what you do not see. Right? The whole journey of faith can be summed up in not knowing what the future holds. Things were no different, of course, for the early church, right? And the writer of 1 John appears to be writing the letter that we just read from this morning in order to address some beliefs that were circulating at the time. In response to this question, Christ is risen, now what? In line with this kind of Greek idea of dualism, that flesh was bad and separate from the spirit, which was good, the teachers that 1 John is responding to believed that God could not have been fully human, fully flesh. That would have debased God, who was fully good, right? Fully spirit, in a way that did not fit into their tiny scheme. So these teachers posited there must have been a man, Jesus, upon whom the Spirit of Christ descended at baptism. And it was this Spirit that gave this man the power to heal and cast out demons and preach with authority. But this Spirit could not suffer. God certainly could not die, so these teachers thought Christ's spirit must have separated from the man Jesus before his death. More than just a heady philosophical debate, for the writer of 1 John, the answer to the question, Christ is risen, now what, was at stake in this belief. You can see it in the passage that we read in his concern for what exactly happened in Jesus' death and resurrection. The writer of 1 John wants the people to know that in dying and rising again, Jesus, the Christ, fully God and fully human, has accomplished for them the forgiveness of sins. He was revealed to take away sin, and no one who abides in him sins. Christ is risen. Now what? Now we'll all go to heaven someday. Right? It's a bit of theology that we've come to take for granted because it's so definite. It speaks to our fear of not knowing how things will turn out. We've turned what Jesus did for us, his life and death and resurrection, into a known quantity, into a certain future. When we reduce the saving work of God to only that, a future hope, a spiritual hope, we are as guilty as the false teachers that 1 John speaks out against. In the gospel reading that Gail read with us this morning, Jesus appears to the disciples in his flesh. He shows them his body. He eats food with them. What was he trying to get them to understand? The resurrection means as much for our spiritual selves later as it does for our real embodied lives even sooner. Christ is risen. Now what? Now, says the author of 1 John, Now we have been called the children of God. Think about what it might mean to be called God's own child. It's a claim of belonging, right? Not only to God, but to a family, to one another. It means that none of us is alone. None of us is abandoned or overlooked. It means that any ways in which the social and cultural and economic systems of the world have told us we are worthless or outsiders or don't belong, that God has adopted us up out of that mess. We are, each one of us, treasured, loved, equipped with just the skills and gifts, the strength and courage, the love and grace that we need to do the work that is before us to do. We are God's children. The writer of 1 John tells us we are God's children now. Never mind that we don't feel like it or act like it. Never mind that we will face challenges that we don't even know about yet. Never mind that we don't know what is coming in the future. We are God's children now. And, 1 John continues, what we will be has not yet been revealed. As we continue to take steps into the future God holds for each of us and for us as a community, I'm sorry to tell you the Bible doesn't have the answers for exactly what will happen and on which dates and in what kind of timeline. But it does have the instructions for how we might best live. We are God's children now. I wonder what it would mean to us or what it might look like if we really lived that way. To have, like our kids do, an overabundance of energy or enthusiasm for what might lie ahead. To remember that we're still learning, that we don't know it all and are just as likely to be wrong as we try to sort out the most basic lessons, compassion, sharing, how to be part of a family. If we are God's children, perhaps we are called to play, to imagine and dream without the constraints of our grown-up pain, of our jaded doubts, to make new discoveries and find wonder in things that we had once taken for granted. Christ is risen, and now, right now, our new life begins. May it be so. Amen.